pleasure to introduce to you Robert Drapkin, oncologist and collector. He has taught medicine at the University of Illinois and at the University of Buffalo. In 1975, Dr. Drapkin was a Chicago Fellow in Medical Oncology at the Memorial Hospital Sloan Kettering, New York City. And in 1979, he served as the attending physician at Roswell Park Memorial Institute in Buffalo. Since 1980, he has served as a clinical associate at USF, and from 1986 to 2006, he was a Moffitt affiliate physician. Dr. Drapkin began collecting nearly 30 years ago, and currently the collection of his photographs numbers 8,000, a number which continues to grow. As a collector of 19th and early 20th century photography and prehistoric American Indian pottery, Dr. Drapkin has made several donations, including the Siskin Estate donation to the University of Kansas, the South Orphan Haas collection to Wesleyan University, Harold Edgerton, Aaron Siskin, and others to the Museum of Fine Arts in St. Petersburg. And I want to say to you all that his interests are even broader than you can imagine, because a jazz record collection, I think it was 10,000 or something, 20,000 were given to the University of South Florida School of Music, so we're very honored to have that gift. He also serves on the Board of Trustees for the Museum of Fine Arts in St. Petersburg, and he also serves on the Advisory Board for the Institute for Research in Art, which I'm very proud that he's joined us in that capacity. Let's welcome Dr. Robert Drapkin.
Take a picture of it. you were to have a camera instead of a right eye and take that slightly different image and put those two images together on a stereo card, on a piece of paper, you present the same vision to your eyes with those photographs that you see. And your brain will fuse those two images and you will see depth perception again. So that's the basis of all of those parts outside. Again, two images, each presented to it, to the eye, each slightly different, used by the brain. If you notice that the sun appears in the same position in each of those two images, because it was farthest away, so things closer to your eyes have a greater change in their appearance, and that's how you, why they look different and why you see depth perception. When you see it greater with something near and far, as opposed to two things far away. Now, we can take those pictures and present them. We have to have a method of taking those pictures. You can do it with two cameras. You can do it with two cameras which are spaced the same distance that your eyes are apart, which is 60 millimeters or 6 centimeters or 2.5 inches. So if you were to take two cameras and put them 2.5 inches apart, you could take those two separate images at the same distance that your eyes are apart, and you could create a beautiful two photograph, and it would look just like those stereos. You could take one camera with two lenses. This is a camera from about 1880. This is a camera from about 1945, 1950. They both essentially do the same thing. The technology was not much different between these two.
The way these stereo images are viewed was
each image going to each eye, and we had a light source. This is an invention of David Brewster in about 1852. This is actually on display. This is a cartoon of that, where you have the stereo card inside a viewer. Each image is presented to an eye, and these viewers were adjustable, so you could actually focus. This is a source of light, usually sunlight. This was a way of viewing images from about 1850 to up until the present. Do you need a viewer to see stereo? To see, take these two images, you don't really need a viewer. Some people can preview stereo images and see three dimensions. Now, how do you do that? Well, the people here who are directly in front of this image, if they were to look directly at the dotting, the left eye at the left image, the right eye at the right image, and gently try to fuse them by looking almost a little across them, you'll see a third image pop in the middle, and that is in three dimensions. So that's called free viewing. And if you go, you can practice this with the images in the front of the museum, by just remembering to put the right image in front of the right eye, the left image in front of the left eye, and then trying to fuse them and just look a little bit cross eyed. And you'll see a third pop in you, which is sort of fun. So you don't really need a viewer. But a viewer is much easier. And this was a viewer invented by Oliver Wendell Holmes. It was very inexpensive. And it helped popularize the stereo car, stereo photography. Also, Queen Victoria was famous for her comment on how wonderful stereo images were about 1851. And stereo photography became a big business up until around early 1900s. Before TV, you sat in your parlor, had stereo cards of all of the places that you traveled to, and you could show them off to your friends, and they would look into the viewer and see this beautiful image in three dimensions, and it is quite attractive. The other nice thing about the viewer, it sort of blocks out everything else, so you're really alone with that image. You develop a kind of intimacy with that image, and it's quite charming. If you haven't tried it, it's still a lot of fun. Some of our history has been captured by stereo photography. And some of these images really don't exist in any other format. Much of the Western United States, photographs of Indians, Western surveys were done in stereo photography. And the first Western stereos were done by Carlton Watkins in Yosemite. He did about 1,000 views. Some of the very important government surveys were photographed by John Hillers, who worked with the first bureau, first chief of the Bureau of Ethnology, John Wesley Powell. They studied the Colorado River. Another famous expedition was that of Wheeler, the photographer was Timothy O'Sullivan. Other great Western photographers were Haynes, Jackson, Houseman, Savage, and Wendridge. These happen to be Norwich images. Many of our wars were captured in stereo photography. And Civil War, Indian Wars, World War, Russian-Japanese War, Spanish-American War, World War I. Most of our World War I photography was done in stereo. Very famous series by Keystone and by Underwood. Underwood became the largest seller of stereo images in the world. They hired photographers to go all over the world and take pictures, and they would sell them. And they were very popular, and they're still available today. If you were to go to New Markets or eBay, you would find literally thousands of these stereo images. These are two images of the Spanish-American War, and they were done by Keystone. The next development really was the development of color film. And someone had the bright idea to combine stereo photography, color film, and create the Viewmaster. An early Viewmaster is on display outside, but these are basically stereo images on a circular disc that's placed inside of the viewer. And again, you have a very intimate relationship with a beautiful stereo image. I'm dating myself, but I remember 3D comic books. 3D comic books utilize what's called an anaglyph, which is two images, one in red and one in blue or green, which are superimposed together. But by using these special glasses, which we don't have here, one is red, one is blue. If you take a, if your eyes behind the blue side of the glasses, you see the, your eyeball won't see the red image. And likewise, if you other eyes behind the red plastic, you only see the blue. So the brain is presented two separate images, exactly the correct distance apart. The brain fuses them and you see a three-dimensional image. And when you take the glasses off, you see this, which is actually this in time. So it was another way of presenting your brain in two separate images, one to each eye, and it fuses them and creates perception of shape. Another interesting way of doing the same thing is a lenticular. And this is a little complicated, but basically, if I use words, it won't mean a thing. So we have to look at what a lenticular image really is. To see three dimensions in a lenticular image, it's a photograph. If you take a photograph, we're going to call it red. We're going to take a piece of it here, a piece of it here, a piece of it here, a piece of it here. And then you take that second image that you want your other eye to see, and you cut it in strips and you put it next to the red image here. And with a special lens that you lay over this, as you look at it, your one eye will see just the red image, and the other eye will just see the blue image. Because of this lens that's placed on top of this image, which is in strips. So again, one eye sees one image, the other eye sees the other image, because of a very fine lens placed over it. And you see the perception of depth. If you were to do this horizontally, you could actually see, because they're two separate images, and the lenses present different images, you see movement. So these are used in advertising on billboards. As you go near the billboard, you see one image of a car moving towards you, and then you go a little further away, and you see the image of the car moving away from you. Quite an ingenious advertising. It's called a lenticular. It's a very fine lens on top of an image of strips. The strips are either horizontal or vertical. The best three dimensions is seen with a hologram. This is an entirely too complex subject to present here. But it's a photographic record of the interaction of two coherent lenses and interference fringes. And it's basically, if you have an object, photographic plate, the laser, beam splitter, which splits the beam of light directly to the plate, bounces it into the object and again to the plate, and the interference of these two beams presents an image to a photographic plate that can be developed and can show you instantly three dimensions, just like the ones back here. That's about as complicated as I think you need to get to this. So, we have three dimensions. We have the perception of death. What is it, art? Well, what's art? Most of our life, we always thought that realistic paintings, Renaissance paintings, paintings that have perspective, like the image I showed you in the beginning of that nice two-dimensional thing, or this image when you see it, it's perspective, it's lines that give you the illusion of depth perception. It's a painting that's like looking out of a window and seeing the real world. But again, it mimics life and it curls of ocean at the very realistic. That was art up until World War I in Europe, and a little bit later in New York City and the rest of the country. Abstract expressionism said that three dimensions are an illusion, a fake. A real painting is a flat surface with paint on it. To be flat is to be pure. No illusions of depth, no perspective. The great proponents of this were Clement Greenberg and Harold Rosenberg. I like to call them Green Mountain and Red Mountain. Another New York Times critic said that realism lacks persuasive theory, which is a crucial lack. In other words, there's real no discussion of what painting this really means. So what? In order to have art, we have to have a theory, we have to be able to discuss it. And believing in that theory is seeing. So, then, the Museum of Modern Wisdom. This was a 1965 Museum of Modern Art in New York City. Art, where they had a flat surface with these curvy lines, giving you the illusion of depth. And this was okay because they had a theory. It said your special optic effects on a flat surface create an image in your brain. So real art is what happens in your brain. They call it perceptual abstraction of art. You don't ever have to worry about what art is because someone is always going to tell you what art is. Never happens. And believing them is seeing. Thank you. Thank you very much.